remember. Thank you. I remember being 16 years old, and when I was 16 years old, I got my first and only speeding ticket in my life. And here's what happened. I was over at my girlfriend's house and just totally lost track of time. And it was a few minutes before midnight. And I had to get home, and it was like a 20-minute drive, and I had like 10 minutes to make that drive. And so I jump in the car, and I'm speeding down this country road trying to get back home before midnight, because this curfew was a big deal to my dad. He was a big believer that 12:02 was not the same as midnight, and so I had to get home on time. And so I'm flying down this country road, and suddenly the lights light up behind me, and you get that feeling like, oh no, everything is over. And so I get pulled over. And he comes up to me and he knocks on the window, and I hand him my license and registration, and we go through this whole deal, and he looks at my license and he looks at me and he goes, you know, you're a minor, so you have a curfew and it's midnight and you were supposed to be home. And I said, yeah, I know. And he says, there's no way from here you would have made it home in time. And then I said this to him, I said, I would have if you didn't stop me, which not like just advice, that got me a ticket, don't do that. So I say that to him, and then I'm just like, oh, good grief. And he's writing up the ticket. And I call my dad, and I had to wake him up and say, hey, just I got pulled over. I have a ticket. And I was just so embarrassed in that moment. And so I get the ticket, and I'm driving home. And listen, my dad's a great guy, but he's also a guy who just has high standards for my life and for the life of my brothers. And so I'm driving home just terrified of what's going to happen. Like, how's this going to all shake out? And I get home, and I'm driving down my street, and I see my house, and it's just the worst sight possible. It's my dad standing outside the front door with his arms crossed with this look of death on his face. Just, standing there, waiting to talk to me about what I did wrong. And I think of this story often. And I think of this story often because I think it's how a lot of you see God. I think a lot of you have this image of God, that he's just this angry father standing in heaven, arms crossed, waiting for you to do something wrong. I think some of you have the image of God, that he's just this angry man in the sky who sees what you did and sees what your life's been about and sees the way you've stumbled and fallen, and he's just angry with you. And so a lot of you spend your whole life wanting nothing to do with God, not because you don't believe in him, but because you think if you go toward God, he's going to reject you. I think some of you have the impression of God that he's just angry about your sin and angry about your addiction and angry about the ways you've fallen down and messed up, angry about the way you've fallen short. And this morning our intention is to offer you what could be for you a life without fear. A life where you don't fear God's judgment anymore. A life where you're no longer afraid of God's judgment toward your sin. And we don't offer you that life because you're not sinful. Actually, the scriptures are going to attest that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So that I'm not saying you shouldn't be afraid of God's judgment because you've done nothing wrong. I'm saying that to be a Christian, right at the core of the Christian faith, to be a follower of Jesus, to be someone who trusts in Jesus, is to believe that I have nothing to be afraid of when it comes to God's judgment, not because I'm awesome, but because God is gracious. That on the cross of Jesus, Jesus absorbed my penalty for my sin. That instead of punishing me, instead of condemning me, instead of putting out his wrath and fury upon me, God puts it upon Jesus so that I don't have to live in fear of his judgment anymore. I don't have to live in fear of God's anger toward my sin anymore, not because I'm not a sinner, but because Jesus took my place. Because Jesus got beat up real bad on the cross, I don't have to beat myself up anymore. Because Jesus got hanged naked and ashamed and embarrassed on the cross, I don't have to live in shame for what I've done anymore. Because Jesus got cut off from God the Father and sent to hell on our behalf, I don't have to be afraid of going to hell anymore. The good news of Jesus is that because of the finished work of Jesus and the cross and resurrection, I don't have to be afraid of God's judgment anymore, because the scriptures say this, that God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You don't have to be afraid of God's judgment anymore. You don't have to live in fear of God's punishment, because the scriptures say this, that there is no fear in love, because perfect love drives out fear. Oh, yeah, we can go up there. So this last week, I had the opportunity to celebrate my 4-year wedding anniversary, which was a fun thing. Yeah, it's crazy. It's crazy. So we get to celebrate 4 years. And let me tell you, in case no one's ever said this to you, marriage is the best. I mean, marriage is awesome. It is such an incredible thing to share your life with someone and get to walk alongside them all the days of your life till death do you part. It's a sweet and beautiful thing. And it's probably not for the reason many of you think. Like maybe there's a lot of girls in the room who think marriage is just always kind of cutesy and flowery and everything's romantic and there's cute pictures. And like, that's true and all, but that's not the best part of marriage. Or maybe there's some guys in the room who are like, marriage is awesome because, you know, you get to do some things, and that's like the thing for you. And let me tell you, like, that's awesome, but that's not the best part of marriage. I want to tell you when I realized what the best part of marriage was. Years ago, it was right in our first year of marriage, I started to have some conflict with someone who came here to this church. And you may think church people don't have conflict, but you're wrong. Church people have all kinds of conflict, and there was this conflict going on, and this guy was just being mean to me, and he was saying things about me, and he was just outright lying about me to people, and it was getting all kinds of messy, and there was all sorts of just stuff going on and things swirling around about it. And I remember I was telling my wife, and I was trying to like argue my case. I was trying to argue why like I was right and she was wrong. I was trying to argue why I was kind of in the right on this, and it was amazing. She just kind of cut me off and said, "I'm on your side. I'm with you. He's an idiot. You're right. I'm with you. I've got your back." And it was this incredible moment of feeling like in this moment she had said to me, like, "I'm with you. I'm for you. I don't care what everyone else says about you. I'm for you. I'm with you. I'm on your side." It was this incredible moment that gave me courage to say, you know what? I don't care what he thinks about me. And if everyone else in the world comes to hate me, I don't care what they think about me either. Because I know what she says about me. And that gave me courage. And that gave me strength in our first year of marriage. So the best thing about marriage to me was having someone who has your back, who has your side, who's on your team no matter what. And I think about this when I think about you guys sometimes, because here's what I know, or here's what I would guess. I would guess this room is filled with people who from time to time are gripped with fear about what everyone else at this school and everyone else in your world thinks about you. So some of you walk around with this total fear that everyone else is judging you and gossiping about you and thinking about you and saying things about you, and you walk around just terrified of that. You walk around anxious of what everyone else is saying, what they're doing with their eyes and what they're saying online and what they're saying on social media. Like some of you are so terrified that you don't listen to the music you like because you want to fit in, or you don't wear the clothes you want to wear because you want to make sure you don't get judged. Like some of you love school and you really love learning, but you're so afraid of being called a nerd or a geek that you pretend it's not really your thing. Some of you really love Jesus, but you're so afraid of getting labeled some kind of Jesus freak that you won't raise your hands up in chapel. You're terrified. And you live your entire life under the fear of what everyone else in this school thinks about you. And here's the good news of the gospel. The good news of the gospel, in other words, what it means to be a Christian is to receive this news that whatever everyone else thinks about you, your God has already said something about you. That based on the cross and resurrection of Jesus, based on the forgiveness we have in him, that God says something about you that no one else can take away. He says, "This is my perfect beloved child of God. This is my perfect beloved daughter, and I delight in her. This is my son, and I am proud of him. I am well pleased in him." You see, the reason I have courage to walk through this world and not really care what you or anyone else thinks about me is because I know what my God says about me. Do you see what kind of courage that could create in you? Do you see what kind of courage and bravery that creates in you when you're just not worried about what everyone else thinks about you because you know what your God says about you? That he says, whatever everyone else thinks, I'm on your side, I'm on your team, I'm with you, I'm for you, and nothing in this world can take that away. I wonder if some of you this week, I wonder if some of you this year need to walk with the courage to know that whatever everyone else in this school and everyone else in your world says about you, your God says that you are holy, that you are chosen, and you are dearly loved, and nothing can take that away from you. Because there is no fear in love. Because perfect love drives out fear. Yeah, 2 days ago, my wife and I got the opportunity to announce some fun news to the world that we're expecting our first child, which we're so excited about. which was like this amazing fun thing when we found out. We're like, this is so cool. And then you're really not supposed to tell people for a while just to make sure everything's okay. And we're like sitting on this big secret. And then we finally got to tell everyone. And it was exciting because it's like people are like giving us little baby clothes and we're like thinking of names. And we're just doing all of this stuff that you do when you're excited about becoming a parent. And it's this new journey for us. And so there's all this excitement, and at the same time, I'm starting to see myself drift into these places that I've never drifted into before, and it's this place of fear. Like, what if something happens to the baby before it's born? What if something happens to my wife while she's giving birth? Like, maybe there's deeper, more, like, insecurities of, like, what if I'm not a good enough parent? What if I don't know what to do? Like, what if I don't know how to be a parent? What if I don't know what this is all about? I start to feel this anxiety. I start to feel this nervousness, this anxiousness, this fear that starts to set in. And so while on one hand I'm excited, on the other hand there's this kind of fear and anxiousness and nervousness. There's this kind of wondering about what's going to happen in the future, about things that haven't happened yet. And here would be my guess. My guess would be this room is filled with people who know exactly what that's like, who know exactly what it's like to be excited about certain parts of your life, but just terrified of other things, just worried about the future, afraid and anxious of what's gonna come, things that haven't even happened yet, things that haven't even been on the horizon, and you're just terrified. Like seniors right now, you're figuring out where you're gonna go to college, and you're figuring out what you're gonna make. Like, you're 18 years old and it's like, what are you gonna major in and do with the rest of your life? And then Lord help us, how you're gonna pay for college. And some of you are just going, I'm so anxious and nervous and afraid of that next season. Or there's maybe freshmen or sophomores, we're over here and you're figuring out high school and you're just getting started. And then if you're anything like me, you're just kind of nervous and awkward in high school and you don't know, you're like terrified of talking to girls. And there's just this like overwhelming fear, right? Or maybe for the rest of you, it's just this fear of like, what if I mess up now and it costs me everything in the future? Like, there is this neurotic high school tendency toward, like, you have a test next week, and if you don't get an A, then your GPA will go down like half a point, which means you won't get into the right school, which means you won't get the right job, which means no one will ever marry you, so you'll end up the, like, lonely cat lady who's alone and crying, and then you'll die. Like, that's the fear some of you have. That everything's gonna go wrong and everything's gonna fall apart. And what if it doesn't work out the way I hoped? And what if I don't get into the school I want to? And what if things fall apart in my family or with my boyfriend or with my girlfriend? What if things fall apart in my life? I think a lot of you in this room know exactly what it's like to live in fear of the future. But here's the good news of the gospel. The good news of the gospel, like right at the core of what it means to be a Christian, a follower of Jesus, is to believe that in the moment I receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior, the moment he enters into my life, it says the presence of God, the very Holy Spirit of God, goes with me wherever I go. So that I walk into the future having no idea what's gonna happen with this child that's coming into the world, having no idea what's gonna happen next week or next month or next year, having no idea, but I walk forward with a confidence knowing that the presence of God goes with me wherever I go and I have nothing to fear. The scriptures say if God is for us, then who could possibly be against us? The scriptures say that no weapon formed against you will prosper, that then there's no one who can touch you, that ultimately there's scary things that can happen. The world can be a terrifying place. The world can even be a tragic place, but I don't have to fear it anymore because the presence of God goes with me wherever I go. So when I think about our world, when I think about our nation, when I think about our community, when I think about my family, when I think about my health and my finances and my future and everything going on, there are plenty of reasons to be afraid. But the invitation to a life without fear is the invitation into a life that recognizes that the Holy Spirit of God, the presence of God Almighty, goes with me wherever I go. And he goes with me and he'll never forsake me or abandon me because he loves me. And the scriptures are clear on this, that there is no fear in love, because perfect love casts out fear.
Well, thank you so much for letting us spend the morning with you guys. And honestly, our hope and our prayer is that as you guys go from this place today, that you would be blessed and that you would take hold of a life without fear. That's our hope. That's our prayer for you guys. So in just a second, we're going to dismiss you, but I just want to make sure everybody's on the same page. Sophomores, you're going to stay in the room. Everybody else, you're going to go on to the rest of your day. So with that, you guys are dismissed. Be blessed. We love you guys.